Hello viewers, welcome to Meet the Press. We love you to use that. On the program that we talk about anything, and we invite everyone from everywhere to talk about issues that are surrounding us. And today we invited the Election Resource Center and some youth to talk about why youth do not participate in elections or in election governance, and why they do not vote when it comes to elections. But this program is brought to us by the Election Resource Center, DRC, and we want to thank them for this, for sponsoring this program. We want to talk more about this, but before we go there, allow me to just, as always, to talk about the coronavirus that is amongst us. Cases are rising every day. We are seeing a lot of deaths coming through, and we want to encourage everybody to ensure that they are safe and sound. They are wearing their masks. Yes, I know I look very much today. It's because of the program, but we encourage you to wear your mask, to sanitize your hands, to ensure that there's social distancing everywhere you are. That said, we are now going to get into the program, and I will let you guys, the panelists, to introduce themselves. And I'll start with you, Mkoma Solo. You have been to the program before. We want to hear from you, where you're coming from, what you have for us today.
Okay, thank you, Lafayette. Thank you to Sustain for hosting the Election Resource Center. My name is Solomon Bogosin. I work with the Election Resource Center. I'm happy to be here as one of the analysts.
All right. Thank you very much, Lafayette. I am Takiona Shishida. I am the Secretary General of the Organization for the Student. Always a good person. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. and thank you very much to the chat. My name is Tanata Zimani. I'm with Food to the Future Trust. We are an organization that we do food to the
future. All right, we want to hear more on why female students or maybe young females do not participate in election governance, but we'll come to you later on.
Thank you very much. I'm Nyoka Kudai. I'm the National Secretary General of the Food to the Future Students Union.
All right, fine. So, as we get into the program, historically, I think we've seen that the ages that are eligible to vote for the young people, that is from 18 to around 35, they do not take part in most of the elections. This is what we want to confront today. Elections are saying they've been doing a lot of outreach programs, they've been trying to find out why this is happening. And just to remind you, we're just a little bit, I think, a little over 2 years before we get into the next election, 2023 election, and it's so concerning, I think, that a lot of young people do not know what is going on, they do not know where to do it before the registration. So, Mkoma Solo, you guys, you've been doing some outreach. Please take us through, give us just a brief background about what you've been doing, what you found out, and maybe what you think can be done.
Thank you for that saying out to you. I think, as you indicated, that we are almost halfway into the other term. So it means we are very close to the next election. That's one of the indicators. It's already ever, somewhere, somehow. What we have seen is that through the various initiatives that we have done, young people have not registered. If I can share with you just now some of the statistics in terms of the national voter registration statistics, it is just shocking. For a rural district like Koromonzi to have 20 registered voters in 365 days, to have Mutoko having 10, Marondera and Mrewa having 20, Sanyate and Chepunzi having 10 registered voters in a period of 365 days, it's just shocking. So we felt that it is important that we work with young people, we support young people to go out and register to vote. So we have a campaign that we are running, it's Register, Elect, and Engage Zimbabwe, which allows for citizens to register, to then vote in elections, participate in the electoral process, and then to engage with the elected leaders, because it is important to also then elect at a later stage, because you don't want to elect someone and then let them loose, let them do whatever they want to do. You need to engage with that person and say, okay, I gave you the mandate to go and represent us, I give you the mandate to do 1, 2, 3. Did you manage to do that? So I think that's a good motivation, especially for young people. If those people that they are electing are in a position to do is exactly as being expected by the young people. So it's one of the critical elements that we have seen. So we've also seen some challenges along the way. which includes access. I think the panelists will be able to discuss further that. But in terms of other processes that are actually coming, that requires one to be registered, that requires the body where it shows the process of registration. Deep intention will be conducted in 2022 in preparation for the elections, where you are actually going to see that there are constituents that have over 70,000 registered people who are going to vote, like Epoe, look at Epoe, look at Arisa, look at Gormon South, look at. You find that those have ballooned to numbers that are unimaginable, but you still find that young people in those locations are not registered still. So it means young people might not be, if a young brother here wants to contest a campaign in an election, he's literally going to be elected by people who are older than him. Yet there are so many people that are of his age that can vote for him and he can win an election. So these are some of the dynamics that we actually see, and these are opportunities for young people. And this is what should actually motivate us as young people to go out and register. Mm-hmm. So delimitation is coming, where the Electoral Commission is going to demarcate boundaries. And those boundaries require numbers to be demarcated. What's the factual? It's the numbers that determines the boundaries of elections. Yes, if young people are not registered, the constituencies might be demarcated using statistics that are wrong, whereas young people might then register at a later age. So I think this is just the background of it. So we are running this campaign, supporting young people to go out and register, supporting people to go out and register, so that at least they vote in the by-elections that are coming, they participate in the, they can be counted in the delimitation process, and then ultimately vote in 2023. We want to decongest 2023. We don't need everyone to go out and register in 2023. That's a great problem.
I think my biggest takeaway from what you just said is the fewer numbers of young people voting. I think one of the challenges that I would want the youth to talk about is, do they know that they are supposed to register and where they are supposed to register? Maybe I can just pose a question to each one of you guys. Are you a registered voter? Did you vote in 2018?
I did.
Did you? Did you register? You're registered. Okay, so at least we are talking to 11 people here. But Nkrumah Sulu here talked about the less number of youth going out to register, and I think at some point he said 10, 30, for the whole year. What are some of the things that are sort of pulling down the youth? I'll start with you. What are some of the things that are hindering the youth to go out and register to vote?
Listen, thank you very much, Lovejoy. thank you very much. The first thing that we believe is hindering young people to register is actually local information. We were conducting this website just before this year and we realized a lot of young people, including some students, actually do not know that the voter registration is open outside the election. People actually think that they are not having the types of things that they don't want to. So maybe if information is in the court, he has. But as students, do we engage each other to say, guys, the voting systems, the voter registration process is open? Do you talk to each other? Yes, we are working on a very ambitious campaign. It's part of our 2020 last general council meeting last year. It's one of the resolutions that we are going to embark on the voter education and registration program in 2020. Because there has always been this thing of trying to educate the 2020, the year before elections. So we are trying to back on this internal money to vote, why they should vote.
Okay, I think I'll turn it back to you to hear more what you have to say. Females in the nation, for a long time now, I think it goes back, even not as bad, but we see that there is less and less female participation, especially young females, especially in water registration and in the voting process itself. What's the problem? What's going on?
Okay, I need to know the factors. Firstly, I would want to note that there is an issue of customer non-voting. Whether they are students, they are students who just say we don't vote. They don't give reason, they just say we don't vote, we don't want anyone, political party, we don't vote, we don't vote anything. So there is an issue of that council that is in that over you. Maybe it is by what Stapio was saying earlier on citizens using prison trust in the Zimbabwe electoral commission and all the process that took place. There is no credit use. We cannot trust the system, not that we cannot trust the system, but then it's even diluted to anyone. And then I can also note that for a number of time, for a long time, women, I can say that they've been disadvantaged because of gender roles. You see, the wake of the lady is child in the area, it's taken to the city. And then the men get to do the duty of looking for money, taking care of the family, and all the financial resources. So I think there has been a gate that has been created for a long time that we are breaking towards the city by issues as women students in the church. We have engaged in campaign for a long time. We have been going to for example, last week we conducted a campaign which we called the Smart Girls. We went to institutions, we tossed females, and then we informed them. Okay. We went to institutions and we informed of the ladies of what exactly they are required to name for them to vote. It was the Smart Girls vote campaign. And then another issue is that when we ask females, when we go to institutions, aside on the national level, when we ask them what exactly they do not register to vote for what even in their institution, they will tell you that they are kind of intimidated. They will say it's set up, we are intimidated by men. Unfortunately, there are still women who are intimidated by men. They cannot vote, they cannot vote to register because they just think it's right, women are just right.
So what needs to be done? Because I think this has been going on for a long time, and now we need to change that narrative. Because it's not true. I just enjoy it. It's a movie. So how do we change that narrative?
Okay, we can empower, we can continue with empowering women, like what we're doing. For example, we're in the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. In this national campaign, we can include the issue of voting, not just focusing on gender-based violence, but also put the archives to put it. We can also include that also of voting into that message. And also, I think we can also partner with other organizations, for example, support to the National and Electoral Resource Commission that is here. To almost see like our political affiliations who we have like one goal in mind, what to improve the state of the nation. So that takes into those ladies. And then we also need to start at the grassroots level, go into those communities, if we could do door by door. And then we speak to those ladies, we understand exactly where they are coming from, one-on-one, besides all the massive campaigns that we do, so that we make an impact that you have in the job.
All right, interesting. I think I like this addition, if you can, as soon as the message here, go and raise the support in this 16 days of activism. I think that is something that can be adopted. I'm sure Anand Komasolo, my youth, do they really care about elections? Do they really care about registering to vote?
I think the major challenge.
May I want to speak up?
I think the major challenge is here, is level of coordination. But I wouldn't agree with them, though, on the fact that they are alluded to the level of trust. Because it's not necessarily the level of trust. Why? You are literally assuming that a certain set of youth really want to vote for a certain political party or entity. But mainly, I would like to introduce, suggest, as I said before, that it's level of communication. And who do we blame? We blame, yes, political parties. they are not motivating the youth enough to make them what to be interested. Like I'll tell you the question that I was asking. Okay, I was talking to this group. We had a conversation about them voting, and they said this. Why should we vote? Why? What is the benefit to us? If a political party actually manages to convey that message to the youth, then I think the youth will be motivated. That would be probably one thing. Us, we are also blamed because we are privy to such information, but we're not relaying it to our family. We are not relaying to others, but we just sit back, we register for to vote on our own, and we don't relay this information. So in the end, the three of us out of the millions who vote, but is the actual result a representation of what is in the greater society? I don't think it's
interesting. What I like about what you just did is you push the blame on the corporate, but you also took the blame on yourself, because you as a youth, I'm not really able to get into something. Alright, moving on. And we also want to mention that this program is brought to you by the Electoral Resource Center, ERC. They are on a campaign to ensure that everybody is registered for the 2023 elections. They're running a hashtag, Sesin Api, Tabe Papi, Alpha. And I'm sure this is a question that you also want to ask yourself as an individual. Tabe Papi, in as far as the 2023 election is concerned. Alright. I talked about young people to take care, all right, that's fine. Also, do we have a crisis of youth voter participation in Zimbabwe?
I think what I would say is, they indicated, I think they've given us some of the issues that are affecting young people from participating in electoral processes. And part of it is the information crisis. You can't say gap. If that gap is not addressed, ultimately becomes a crisis. If, for instance, Zach knows that there is a Form 2 student who will be 18 by the time that we are getting into the next election, and then there is no plan for that person to be engaged, I think surely it will be a crisis. Because then it means how many students are in Form 2 now in Zimbabwe. And then by the time that we finish the year, and then we finish 2020, 2021, 2022, how many millions are those? Mm-hmm. And then finally, when all those millions that are accumulating between 2018, 2020, 2019, 2020, 2021, when they finally come to you in 2023 and they all say we want to register, that would be a big push in terms of the budget, that would be a big push in terms of the human resources, requirement to say to go out and register, that would be a crisis. So those people would then say, okay, they are not ready to undertake this process. Yet this process could have been done continuously. So it is important that all the stakeholders that are supposed to have a part to play in the electoral process, they play that part, including ourselves, to mobilize each other, just like Tapio was saying. We need to tell each other, this is the correct information, because we can't then say there is no correct information, yet we have that information. We are institutions. The four of us here, including others who are not part of this panel, we are institutions with stakeholders that are related, whom we can actually use, like she indicated, that we need to even go door to door. Who does door to door? It's us as well. So the blame, you took the blame on all of us. I think it's our responsibility to ensure that crisis does not happen in 2023, where we have these young people coming all out and wanting to register. So this is why exactly ERC is containing such platforms. And then at this particular point in China, we are saying, okay, for some young people, they are saying it's about access. Well, the voter registration centers are centralized. Mm-hmm. Like here in Harare, it's just here, Jason Moyo, Kona Jason Moyo, and Sisi House.
Yeah.
And then you are asking someone from Yetcliff to board a combi, come into town, then stay for 3 hours waiting to be registered. After that, go to another combi, go back. And then someone in Seke, the whole of Seke district, Shumbiza, Seke Rural, they have to come to Makoni, to Seke Teachers College. And then you find this centralization system, it becomes a challenge to young people, because we have other things that we are also doing, and we need access, ease of access. So we've, in that regard, we have organized with other stakeholders to then start a shuttle service, which will then go into Wobbly, which will go then to Redcliffe, go to Zarasewa, pick young people, bring them to the voter registration center, and then once they register, we take them back. We then provide them with the information that they require as well. If they require the affidavits for proof of residence, we then provide with the support of the lawyers that are volunteering their services to the campaign. They get commissioned affidavits, which works as their proof of residence. So I think this is also in line of what they said, that we don't have to blame, we have to find a way of resolving the challenge. So if they want us to go to the University of Zimbabwe, Women's University, Catholic University, Urban State University, we will be able to facilitate that, because we realize that we don't need to wait for the crisis to be declared a crisis.
All right, interesting. Decentralization is very key. There's one person that has come through on our Facebook comment section, and thank you guys for commenting on that. If you've got any questions for these guys, please just post it and then we'll read it out to them. The question was pertaining rural youth. I think you were talking about, just hearing what you're saying, I think your program is tailor-made, specifically maybe for urbanites, semi-urban, peri-urban. I didn't hear something that is tailor-made for rural youth. Are you going to penetrate into those areas, and how are you going to do that? Because for a long time, those rural youth are sort of left behind.
Okay. Thank you, Love, for that. I think my other panelists will probably address certain components of that question, which was my question. But when we looked at the demographics in terms of voter registration, you find that rural youth will register because the conditions in the areas where they reside are conducive for them. If they want a proof of residence, they will simply get it from the village. Whereas for the urban youths, if you want a proof of residence, you have to go to the commission of courts, who ask you for a fee. You have to get it for a fee. Whereas in rural areas, you get that from the village head. If you want to get an ID in rural areas, of course, those mobile lists that are done by the registrar, general staff, they go into schools, they allow those processes. But you find that in urban areas, it's very limited. Mm-hmm. So you have realized that urban areas become sort of a marginalized community in that elite type of an environment. We find that most of the young people that are not registered, they are here in urban areas. Mm-hmm. Everyone else has moved from their locations. We are all here in this studio alone. We are more than 15 of us who are not in our locations. So even if the registrars people get into our communities to say we are registered people, we are not there. We are found in the CPG. We are busy with these assignments. That will take 8 hours of our day. Mm-hmm. So the time that we only have is on a Saturday. And on a Saturday, you go to the voter registration center, they are closed. We close on Friday. Mm-hmm. So you find that the urban communities are the ones that are actually the marginalized in terms of voter registration. Rural communities are registered with close to 85%. Whereas the urban communities, some of them, you find that they've registered at almost 48%, 52%, 51%. Look at Lawayo, the last election. Less than 50% of the population registered for the election. But Lawayo is largely an urban community. So you find this. And then you look at probably National and Central, registered at close to 90% of all the communities, because it's largely rural, so the conditions would also be different. So the marginalization efforts, marginalization of our urban communities, we have actually realized it creates so much of the problems. So go to Sisu House, you find that there are so many people that are trying to register now. And then go to probably Murumbets, you find that you will not get so many people actually queuing to register in that community, because it's a rural community. You will get the opportunity through the mobile or voter registration bits, the village gets mobilizes, whereas here in the areas, there's organizations we do their into.
Okay. That's very interesting. Thank you so much, Kumasolo, for that. Chapi, once you knowledge is telling more. But I think the question that I want to ask you, Anisha, you talked about lack of trust in the voting process, right? In the registering process, right? How do we then break through to those that doubt the whole process? To just say, no, guys, go and vote, go and register, vote. And I don't know, you know, okay, information in the ERC,
and then Zek, and then well, and then on Sculpture and Commerce. How do you break through to those guys?
Firstly, we have complained about Zek system for far too long.
Mm-hmm.
But if we add opportunities, if we add, say, if this is wrong, if we add junior talents, what is to happen?
Mm-hmm.
Number one. So instead of just continuing to say, ah, this, the playing field is low, why not take initiatives to be able to play the playing field ourselves? We can do that, number one. Number two, like Omar Solo was saying, there is a scarce guy between the voters and those who voted. Like they were saying, they are running a campaign called Tarababi, where are we now? Those who elected 2019. And you know, the absence of a social contract right now between the government and the government is shocking, if you're sick. So you find a situation where young people no longer see the reason why they should vote. So instead of continuing to tell people to go and vote for those amateur, we as the politicians we're taking a stand to say in any other election from the by-election that are coming soon, we are going to support every progressive young person who's going to stay in the election. Why are we doing that? We realize that, like those of the old said, elections have turned out to be just a new opportunity. In this case, the oppressors I refer to every old person who's been closing the space for young people. Irrespective of political party, every old person has been closing political space for young people. Every young person is an oppressor. So it is time to take the power as young people. Make sure that we support each other. Make sure that we give orders in that issue driven and fixed based to make sure that we tackle issues. That are relevant to us, that speak to the concrete realities of our own people,
mm-hmm.
of our generation.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are to restore the social contract between the government and the government, we are to make sure that we give, like my brother was saying, we need to give young people a reason to vote.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. We need to give young people a reason to vote.
Yes.
One of the things that we look forward to, and like the director said, we belong, right? It's the sense of belonging, and I'll come to you, right? And for a very long time, they've been complaining that it's our bias towards me, right? I'm sorry for that. They've been complaining that it's women, especially young people, are not given enough political clout, political positions within political parties. Do you think maybe these women are in charge of those? Do you think at the end of the day, as young female voters, you say, I can't vote register. I can't vote more from a voter. And you would say, sure, I'm going to have a chance to say, I'm going to have a D, and do I need to continue to pass?
Interesting question. So I'll have to agree with what you're saying, because firstly, I would like to allude to that. Most of the young people that we're talking about, young women that we're talking about, let's ask ourselves this question. Right now we are there. And they are these guys, we want to have a mother. We told Magazar, they are saying those women that we're talking about are the vendors, but we're not from Mazuko, I think it's about things like that. So for those people, what's more important to them is sustaining livelihood. It's about age, our nation flag. So we have to disseminate information. These young girls and these women need to vote, because for them what's important is gaining a living. You understand what I'm saying? Because unfortunately the economy in Nigeria has been crumbling for years.
Mm-hmm.
So for them it's crucial to put our plan. And then I'll get to what you say, which is the kind of challenge and doing. And it has to be true. If you look at it, you are speaking about Amadad, and that's the system in our nation, I'm saying, and even in the pandemic, for your communities, you see that we are talking about young people, and you ask ourselves, by people that are the young people that represent us, the people that we vote for, if we look at their ages, they are not even young people. We are talking about 35 or 36 year olds, you are living with the young people, you know what I'm saying? And then I also want to allude to the fact that young women, let's say when they decide to take up the position, when they decide that now, you know, questions should be such a man, Mr. Obama. we have to look at the issue of resources. Which is today we have the resources compared to the other dollars who already have the resources, who already have the state resources that they are using, you know, coupling up my rural areas and all that. These young women do not live. And for us young women, let's say we are not spending enough coupling up. Obviously, I'll go and vote for that young person, even if I didn't want to vote, because I know there's going to be a person who's going to represent my votes. Understand what I'm saying?
All right, interesting. You brought out the issue of economy, which I think is a very, very important aspect. You're saying most of them are spending most of their time selling, and these are people who are supposed to be going in the register. And this is the informal maybe you can come to here. How much time is needed for one to go and register the vote?
Okay, so I think it will depend. One, I think Tapiwa had mentioned the issue of trusts, the trust issues as well. If you go to one registration center, you'll find that it may take you 5 minutes. Less than 5 years once you get in, you are registered. But in other centers, because of the attitude of the people where the issue of reforms come in, when you talk of reforms, people think that we're talking of this big thing where we need to write a whole big document to change certain things. No. It is about the attitude of the person. If I come in here, I'm coming in here for a certain type of a business to do with 263. Then once I get in here, I start to look at the people that are in the room. What are their attitudes towards me? This is exactly what young people look at. If I get into a voter registration center, what is the attitude of the person that wants to register me? If their attitude is a negative attitude towards me, then I start to live that build up. So whatever then happens after that becomes a problem. So it seems getting the registration center, someone tells you that okay, we don't have the affidavits for you to sign. Whereas those are supposed to be there throughout the process, you need to prepare the plan to make sure that you have enough for everyone to be registered. What? So those are some of the trust issues. They are very minor in the peripheral issues, but they really affect young people. Because imagine you have left your tick, you have closed for just 1 hour, you want to register the vote, and then you get there, someone is taking tea, and then instead of taking tea for just 20 minutes, they go for 1 hour, 20 minutes. What would you do for your business? So these are some of the things now that are hindrances to young people. Because they want a system that is efficient, a system that responds to their needs. You mentioned that young people are on WhatsApp. In the end, the advert that says going to register is on ZTV. How many people are watching ZTV? Those are some of the cases. So these are some of the small things that needs to be formed in terms of even the administration of the electoral process by itself. And this does not require us to change the law. Nelson Mandela Parliament. No. They require ZEC to institute certain measures amongst themselves to simply say, okay, we have new procedures, new regulations for our staff. To say, if you are going for tea, it's well written outside that tea is between 10 to 10 minutes. And then when I come in, and I know that I have come in at 10 past 10, I know that someone is going for tea because it's clearly 10 outside that there will be tea break. Now, if you get to some of the registration centers, you'll be shocked. Some of them are not much. Some are closed. Some when they closed in March, on 30 March, when that directive was issued, some have never opened. Some will ask them, they'll tell you that if you want to come with people to come and register, first call us so that we tell you that someone will come and attend you. So these are the attitudes that will create problems, that will create the trust issues that some of the young people might hear from what with the electoral commission. So this is important. I think the information is important, especially when it's coming from young people. So it is upon us now. How we have actually maneuvered around that is we have to call them before we dispatch a shuttle to their office to say, okay, we are dispatching a shuttle that is coming to 89 people. Can you be ready for them? So that at least we don't create this environment where young people are always anxious about the electoral commission. So building trust is our responsibility. As young people, as the electoral commission, as whoever in the electoral stakeholder, they also need to start working towards building that trust as well. Because it is important for our electoral process. This is our only country. We don't have anyone, we can't give this country to anyone else. So if we have that attitude, I think we'll get sound.
Interesting. So, trust. Trust in the system, trust in the process. I think you don't want to be able to do this. You don't want to be able to do this. All right. I'm going to go to the process, right? How much of a political leader does he or she influence my youth with an voter? Let's say we've got Mr. Nelson Chamisa, MDC, we've got the President Emmerson Mnangagwa, we've got other political leaders. How much power do they use to influence on, or to help influence on you and on how you're going to go, on whether you're going to vote or going to register?
Thank you very much for that question. I was actually get just to explain part about that. Anyway, I don't think we have to blame the Madalas for not involving us in this electoral process. Why? Because look at the statistics. We are youth, we are plus 64% of the total population.
And this is unconfirmed?
Yeah, yeah. and at the same time, that's according to the assessment. Okay. And at the same time, we are 44% of the total voters currently. And the funny part is, in 2023, there are around 2 million eligible new voters. So look at the statistics. But who are the actual voters? It's worrying you very, very low. And is it beneficial to the political party? Is it benefiting to the political party? It's not. So if they don't include you as youth, I don't think that because you're not bringing anything to the table. You are not actually affecting the outcome of the day. But yes, the youth, it's true that Zimbabwe is a useful community and is a useful population and the youth have the power to actually swing the election.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, look at the participation. Who then actually votes and who then actually stands for a position, for instance. It's worrying me, you know. So if this political party choose not to influence us as youth, it's not their problem. It's our generational problem. It's not a political problem. It's not a political party's problem or Madalas' problem. It's ours to solve. It's us. We are supposed to be taking this thing, not looking up to Madalas to involve us. When surely we are not really beneficial currently, we are not beneficial.
But kuma party pamwe kubva nekuma pato amakamirira inini anazipofuzi nazvo nyaya idzi dzekuti mama leaders ane ane influence dziri kumbotaurika here?
Yes. Well, the issue is what we focus on maybe is let's have our constituents participating in this election. By elections, the general election, we would want our constituents also to take part, actively take part, not just passing and just going there to vote because someone influenced someone, influenced us, so and what the secretary. But we want as the youth to participate in this process.
But my point, this is Bamuri, I see you want to say something. My point, this is Bamuri. My youth are there, which voting process in English.
The youth is still
Oh, I mean, what's our registration, sorry?
The SAG is set up this program. Very few people actually know. Because after we came to that organization, that we sold it to our last to our country. That in 2021, we're going to be back in the country. Because it was after the realization that most young people do not actually know that voter registration is open out of the region.
ERC, I know that yes, you're one of the key organizations that are doing the border registration. Muru Tower, Muru Pier, Kunevana, Muru Pier, Mama Schools, I would see more of the border registration never pushed as Ragata, and I'm not disappointed with Ragata.
Okay, so what we are doing now is upon realizing the low registration numbers. We are engaging with organizations that are willing to work with us, no matter where they are, even if they are in rural areas. So they are community-based organizations that are in rural areas that we actually been engaged with. Where we want to mobilize for the right numbers, for everyone to be registered to vote. So for us, it's not now an issue of who are we working with. We just want everyone to be registered. So even if they are political parties, they want some support, some form of support, even if they are community-based organizations, even if they are tertiary institutional organizations, we are getting into those communities. This is why we are convening such platforms. Because we realize that with young people, we can't convene a meeting under the tree with NASU, with COSU, with FSNT. They are different. But with certain organizations, we'll convene in their locations, in their localities. Because for those young people, they are following 263. Because that's where they get their news, that's where they get their information. And this is exactly where we are in this particular country. So we are doing a lot with them. And as I have actually indicated, that offer again for shuttle service. It's not an ELC shuttle service, but it's for them to facilitate their members to go out and get this support. So we're working with all of the other organizations. I think I can just give a rundown for Mashimbo, Mashimbo Residents and Taxpayers Association, Contract, Tel Zimbabwe, CCGOP Mashimbo, Zimrights Mashimbo, Yenarai, we're working with Cora, Biset, Zimrights, Zikosu, I think the engagements in the last few days. FSNT, NASU again, where we want this to be a national character. So we are going everywhere where we feel that there are young people that need to be registered. So we are not limited, so we are going everywhere. And this is exactly where we are aiming. I think we would call the shared call center number, which is a toll free, where people can actually even call in to say, we are here, we are organized. We would want to send a whole shuttle to where people are missing. We would want it to be a bit of an organizing group with the numbers that can convince us to then say, okay, we are taking a shuttle there because we want to also value for the money that we will.
Interesting. Thank you so much, Mkoma Solo, and we continue our engagements. Thank you so much to those who are tuned in, who are following us, who are following this discussion. We appreciate you, and the program is Meet the Press. We invite you again to come and talk to us. And I think because of time, we want to wrap this up. My teacher is in institution. Do we have maybe time? You are a nurse leader, right? Yes, a course leader. Do you have maybe time that you engage NEMA students, maybe once a week, to talk about voting rights, talk about voter registration, talk about the voting process itself?
Yes, we do.
Oh, NEMA is what is of the market, not only
unique. You see, our institution is trying to exactly be as clear as we want to be in such cases. Of course, every time we complete students, for purposes of doing the most important courses, we are always accused of trying to find the do you know what that means? How we are studying administration as a discussion and other things. But whenever we can, whenever we convene our membership, whenever we even have to speak to students, using every other data we can use, we always make sure to try to encourage an active citizen. We always try to make sure that we encourage a culture of asking people of questions to the people as well. Always try to make sure that we organize everyone. Always trying to make sure that we become a generation that is focused on issues that are actually important to the first discussion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, my sister, time has only 2 years, just a little over 2 years to speak, but we'll actually go to 2023 elections. And Mukhtar, you know which young people must be shown. Twitter saying, what are the solutions? What do we do? What's the way forward?
As we were saying earlier,
when
we stand us to come together as West and put which we can just come together, forget whatever that is behind us, then we go and preach the message of voter registration, we go to communities, we preach the message of voter registration, we go to door to door, like we say, we go and empower my youths so that they can participate back in the same area. Or we are the majority of the population in Zimbabwe. What if we just come together and say we are going to vote? Imagine what would happen. And that is it. We get in the set, that is just it.
Okay. Could, do you think my youth should be incentivized to register to vote?
I think the right way would be motivated.
Is it still my Okay. Mkomasolo, 2018, Tangatine, a bit of a lower youth voter registration. From your standpoint, do you think it is going to be a repeat of the same?
Okay, thank you, Lovejoy. I think if we don't take action and we continue to speak without the requested action attached to the statements and whatever, we'll actually have a similar problem. Because now we have the young people that voted in 2018, some of them having graduated into adulthood, and then they will not be counted in the young people's bracket. So it means if we don't take action now, we are likely to have even a lower number than the one that we had in the 2018. So I think it's a call for us to act, it's a call for us to start preparing, because we have an opportunity now to prepare ahead of the election, unlike in 2018, where we started to run around in 2017. So in this particular point in time, we have started early, we should be able to reap better dividends in terms of the number that we are going to see in 2023. Probably I will share also the toll-free number.
Yes.
It's an opportunity to share the toll-free number. On this number, you can call for free,
okay.
Request a shuttle, request for electoral information. I think it's one of the platforms that we have created, since you have yet that information is a problem as well. Where we need to share information, people can inquire about the processes where there are violations, can report incidents. What we need, if we want to trust the process, we should be able to report our problems. And then if those problems are resolved, we will not have trust issues. So the toll free is 08 08 0219. So that's a toll free line. People can call in for free as long as you have battery and network. When you come through, and then it will be attended. Either as a report, you're either making a report of issues and incidents and problems, or you are requesting for a shuttle service, or you want to share something with us that is interesting, or you want to us to send a message close to it, in terms of, especially if it's related to elections, we can compile those and share. So I think that's toll free. It's also an important platform for communication with citizens, for providing information and for engagement.
Okay. Tapio, this is one person that also came through from the viewers. They are talking about the political violence affecting youth participation in voting, in the voting processes. In 2018, luckily, yes, there were minor cases of political violence leading into, electoral violence leading into the elections. But soon after, we saw a lot of skirmishes happening, and a lot of victims were in the youth. And now we are plus or minus 2 years before the 2023 elections. And yeah, the political violence. Do you know what I was saying? Do you know the national register and it's a bad. I'm after it, it's a bad register. I'm not sure who I think it's inside the
Okay,
if you disagree,
was it a conversation with the
CCP?
And she was saying that. So you see, we have a problem today where young people actually think that violence is something that is normal in politics. So we need to move from a culture of violence. And do you know the reason why there is so much violence in Zimbabwe as well in politics? It's because we've been calling the politics of cultures and nineties, the politics of I would say it's a very much approve of it, but I think after this session.
Okay,
thank you. So I think it's on us as young people. No politician is worth dying for, and also no politician is worth killing. But every issue that affects us as young people, if we are to go on an issue given debate, we could go far and we could make sure that we make a cleaner political environment.
Mm-hmm. All right, interesting. My sister Tapio talks about issues. How much of political message does it influence someone who can register? Because you have to register. As you have to vote, as you have to vote, but you have to register. I mean, do you think we see Makanzwa, let's just give an example, Zim Lindo, shall you have to change? Do you think we should be motivated enough to not register and not register? You have the issues. Do not get to see. You have the registration.
Much influence on voter registration because I think when this day, which is the same situation I've got to admit that, which is usually this political leaders, for example, they just follow the manifesto of one event, even Mamucha, even Christopher, I mean, it's just the same thing. But all the time, it's a day, but it's like, Nagana manifesto, like, he's just following the National Party manifesto. So, why exactly should we vote for using a certain information like our lawyer? So I'm just saying that people need information like our lawyer before they go through. But we have to manifest that because these young people will be educated. Zimbabweans need my young people I can't do that. So when they come to us with this message, to not hear it, to not to know, to know, to tell yes, but then you understand what I'm saying. So I think there is need for leadership training. Understand before voter registration.
Okay.
To those people that come to us wanting us to vote for them, you understand? Because she made the end of no vote because I trust in the person that I'm voting for. Before I register, I should trust that when you vote will make a change. Not just the system, you have to put a bunch of voters and then there is no change for many years and then
Interesting. I like that idea. Leadership training. Because this was no war during my campaign. And this I'm called judge of the day.
I think full support what the police is saying. I think we need to unite in our lives. Yes, we might have different views on certain topics, but we should unite towards a youth centered. I think at the same time, relay the information. The information should be relayed to the last person. You know, we shouldn't be voting like what she said. We shouldn't be voting for a manifesto or a document that was drafted by someone who's not even an MP or a councillor of the community. You want to vote for someone for his way, probably commitment and probably integrity. You'd want to vote for someone you are sure they will represent your community's interests too. So it's wiser, I think, that if we relay the information down to the last person, down to the folk who we're talking about, they should know also why they are voting, and if they are to choose someone, they have to be well informed why they are choosing that specific. Because in the end, youth we have a problem now, we just complain.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this council, this MP. Yes, it's from both parties. We have MPs from the opposition, MPs from the
mm-hmm.
But in the end, we just complain. But if you ask that person who was complaining, did you vote?
Yeah.
Did you try to at least make your voice heard? They didn't. All the deep of substance is complaint. So in the end, what change are you bringing? Nothing. Are you adding to this, or you are just adding to the problem?
Mm. Saka, in a nutshell, change not only get up on the register, no problem. This happened to you.
Yes.
Mm. As we wrap up, and once again, thank you so much for sponsoring this program. I think something that is going to help a lot of young people. traders say moving forward, I think in the end it's a tower, it's a tower, but in India will say ERC. The Abmatan, including zero means my youth, but I don't go home about time, school that patrol means a violence, kind of political violence, patrol means a mismanage, that's in it, patrol means my issues. How do we then, can I say, box that message into one and encourage my youth to find and register? Because they are able to register.
Okay, so why it is important you look at that campaign that we have, looking at some of the problems that are there, where we are calling on those elected to then say, where are we with the issues, the problems that have been there before? We can't continue these problems. We need those resolved. So I think it is important that the first step is, if we register to vote, we are in a better position to demand accountability from the leaders. We are in a better position to make our voice heard. We are allowed to petition if we have problems, if we feel that we have genuine problems. We are allowed to petition Parliament, we are allowed to petition the President, we are allowed to petition the Electoral Commission, we are allowed to petition the Ministry. It's there in the Constitution. So these channels, we need to make sure that communities have information that can actually be very useful for them to engage with the elected leaders. So this is why we're saying you also register, elect, and then you engage. Because if you register and you vote, and then you don't engage with the person, ultimately the election would end up not making sense. Because it needs to make sense. The vote needs to make sense somehow. For an educational policy to be responsive to the issues of the young people in the 21st century, it means you have to engage with the minister. Because the minister might be 65, the minister might be 70, you might not know. Because they might have been standard, B standard, whatever. That was their education system. And in this COVID-19 scenario, where learning has to be online, you are struggling to get equipment in universities. Why is it like that? Because we are not engaging with those in authority, and they don't know our issues, or they know our issues, but we have no platforms where we are legitimate people to engage with them. You know, people will say, you have heard people saying, you didn't vote for me, so why should I come and give you a service? Yet, once you are elected, you are responsible for everyone who is in that particular location or in that particular locality. So it is important that as young people, we engage, we register to vote. After our voting, we then continuously name those people that we have elected. We then say, okay, where are we with these issues? Because once you don't ask those questions, elections will not have any value on us. So I think it is important that we continue to engage. I think the platforms that are being created, the shuttle services, the call centers, I think this is why we advertise them, so that at least citizens will get information, young people get more information, young people will have access, and then once they have access, we improve our environment.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Nkuma, for inviting us. And what I picked is register, elect, and engage. For one second, register. Though I think message in Utah, ERC, while you have to choose the Chumba Janasi and the Chumba Tender, ERC, and not send my youth leaders, the Kana, the Kosu, FSN, Pimus Network, and Zanasu, for coming to the program and maybe sharing with us the youth concerns and what can be done. We get them, we get their voices, and I'm sure it's an ERC, no woman, man who was in the tower there, who might want to help out in the registration process, can also do the same, so that as you know, 2023, tiny my unit arrived one day and one sub tower in one voice and one sub community leaders of their choices. That said, the program was Need the Press. My name is Love Junto Lisa. Thank you so much for joining us on this program. Thank you so much to all our online viewers who were with us, and thank you so much for the comments. We aim to have you on the program. Please feel free to get in touch with us if you want to go on the program for any other issues that you might have. That said, thank you so much, and may God bless you, and see you in other programs.